Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
So let's start with a presentation for today, and it's about the diagnostic approach to peripheral neuromuscular disorders. Coming to the neuropathy, please understand the pattern of involvement, proximal distal, combined, distal predominant, if there is a family history or not, and common etiologies, and we're going to talk about that briefly. But final question is it treatable or not? So if you know the etiology, then you're going to treat it. And here goes the etiology. So a good number of patients are having diabetic neuropathy. So please, 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 just think three times before you think about something else. Especially if it is fitting in the pattern, do the oral glucose tolerance test, whatever, whatever. And even still, if you don't find anything else, still it could be diabetes. And can present really in demyelinating kind of pattern too. So, but that's why that cryptogenic axonal polyneuropathy, that most of the time falls into diabetic neuropathy, as a matter of fact. You can see these are two bigger pieces of the pie. Then the toxic polyneuropathy, immune-mediated polyneuropathy is a big chunk I don't want to miss because it's treatable. So do emphasize on that. Hereditary neuropathy, still no treatment, but still for peace of mind, for understanding the progression of the disease and counseling of the patient, this is important. Polyneuropathy with systemic diseases, metabolic polyneuropathy, B12 deficiency, again, is treatable. So it's important. So treatable disorders need some more focus, and idiopathic small fiber neuropathy. Okay, myasthenia gravis, incidence, as you can see, 9 to 10 per million, prevalence is 14-20 per 100,000. Thymoma is seen in 10 to 15, so we tend to do CT of the chest in all the patients. If there's any particular question about when, how we should do the thymectomy or not, I'm happy to answer that question in terms of generalized myasthenia gravis or ocular myasthenia gravis or seronegative cases. So there is a whole variation for each part with respect to the antibody status, with respect to thymoma, with respect to the age and all. ISPEC test, I will recommend, I particularly have that over here because I want you guys to know this is a bedside test, easily available. It may be in the exam scenario. I do it all the time. It's very sensitive and specific, as a matter of fact. The sensitivity goes from 80% to 90% for these this simple test. Sometimes we combine this test with single fiber to increase the sensitivity even more to diagnose these patients, but initially it's for seronegative patients. That ISPEC test is helpful only for the ocular patients, not for the generalized myasthenia gravis. But as we discussed, myasthenia is affected by the temperature of the environment. So if fatigue is more worse after exercise, which could be a kind of general scenario in all the neuromuscular conditions, but it is way more than expected, that especially with the bulbar symptoms, it could be myasthenia gravis. So ISPEC test has a very high sensitivity. It's a bedside test, and that would be very helpful in patients with ocular myasthenia gravis. There's a whole scheme. It's like it has to be 2 millimeter change of the droopy of the eyelids, and it has to be applied for 2 minutes. So there's a details to ISPEC test, which I can share if anyone like. But this is more important, drugs causing toxic myopathy and neuromuscular junction disorder. More importantly, botulism, snake venom, organophosphorus, curare, but as we use magnesium very frequently, please be careful because that's a big no in patients where there's suspected myasthenia gravis because they land into myasthenic crisis. So if you remember the list, this is what I would recommend. Remember magnesium, immune checkpoint inhibitors are very commonly used. They can induce myasthenia gravis, which is gonna be seronegative, as a matter of fact. And if you withdraw the drug, they do get better. So repetitive nerve stimulation could be helpful in these patients to understand, is it coming from the ICI or is there some other reason? D-penicillamine, macrolide, aminoglycoside, class 1A antiarrhythmics and corticosteroids, unless you use it controlled, are big time contraindicated in patients with a definitive diagnosis or even with a suspected diagnosis of myasthenia gravis. So these are the big in the list. So there are other medications we should be cautious about, like statins, like beta blockers, calcium channel blockers. Those may precipitate in patients, especially those who are not well controlled as a baseline. But these drugs are, we need to be more careful about. Tetracycline is not part of it, so just remember that. So tetracyclines can be used. Okay. Myopathies can be induced or worsened by cimetidine, levodopa. Levodopa can give you neuropathy too, as a matter of fact, which is sensory. Statin, colchicine, chloroquine, labetalol, vitamin A, vincristine, alcohol, steroids, kind of a general pattern, and non-depolarizing neuromuscular junction blocking. Again, non-depolarizing drugs are contraindicated, but depending on the anesthesia, what's required, controlled medication can still be tried. Even they mentioned about Botox, that can be done in patients who are having cervical dystonia. Again, there's a whole different discussion how to titrate the dose of Botox in those patients. So when we talk about the treatment options, myasthenia has recently picked up a lot because there are many new therapies after so many years coming into the market. So other than the usual oral immunosuppressants, there are new infusion therapies. So there's a limitation because these patients need to come to the hospital to get those infusions. And now there are new drugs came out just last 2 years, which are the bottom two, Rystiggo and Zilbrysq, where it's subcutaneous. So it's still nurse supervised, but after the first shot, patient can do it at home with the convenience as well. But more importantly, what I want to emphasize is this slide, which is mainly for the medicine team. So understanding what immunization these patients need. So if it's a live vaccine, those are contraindicated in patients with immunosuppressants or those who are immunosuppressed for some other reason. Influenza can be done, but not the live vaccine. Tdap is okay. MMR contraindicated, varicella contraindicated, VZV contraindicated. Also talking about the more importantly, the one I want to emphasize is the bottom one, meningococcal vaccine. If the patient is due to get or to be started on Soliris or other complement inhibiting medicine, there has to start a vaccination more than 2 weeks before the start of the infusion. But if the patient need to start the infusion early on, you need to start the prophylactic antibodies, antibiotics in these patients. And the vaccination these patients get gonna get is the quadruple medicine with the MEN2B. So these are the vaccines these patients need to have before they start these complement inhibiting therapies. So that is something very important. So this is something we send our medicine, our patients to medicine department to complete their vaccination before they come back to clinic to get started on infusions. So myositis, there's an overlap. So dermatomyositis, polymyositis kind of clumped, okay? So they feel there are very rare cases of polymyositis, but primarily it's dermatomyositis. And we all know there is association with cancers. Immune-mediated necrotizing myopathy and inclusion body myositis are clumped too. I'm gonna talk about that in the next slide. Then comes the next myositis disorder, which is antisynthetase syndrome, and then there is an overlap myositis. When we come across a vignette or a question where there is a question about myositis, always check if they mention anything in terms of myocarditis or interstitial lung disease, because that will actually rule out inclusion body myositis and immune necrotizing myositis. It's gonna be either dermatomyositis or antisynthetase syndrome. So these are the whole list of antibodies that we do. The top list is for the dermatomyositis antibodies. The next list is for the antisynthetase. So just remember anti-Jo. I saw a few patients with the anti-Jo positive, but those are the antisynthetase syndrome. Then comes the signal recognition particle and HMG-CoA, which is for the statin-induced myopathy. And these patients are actually in the group of immune necrotizing myopathy, which is confirmed on the muscle biopsy. You cannot confirm that diagnosis without muscle biopsy, unless you have the antibody positive and you have very high CPK. Then comes, as we talk about the dermatomyositis, where the elderly is gonna be high, differentially more than CPK. But on muscle biopsy, they're gonna be perifascicular muscle atrophy. That is important. Again, with the HMG-CoA, I think I do have it in the next slide. These patients also tend to have muscle atrophy. With the myositis, there doesn't need to be. There could be muscle necrosis, but it may not be muscle atrophy. So if it's a muscle atrophy, again, it's a little differential point, fine point to understand. So as I said, it could be seen in HMG-CoA related myopathy. So for the HMG-CR myopathy, it could be either statin intolerance or statin-induced toxic myopathy. In those two cases, if you just stop the offending drug, patient should get better. But if the patient still continues to have ongoing muscle damage, then it is an immune process and patient may need immune therapy. But classically, these patients may have more dysphagia, high CPK in thousands. Muscle biopsy is helpful in these particular patients. and there is a more than regular population association with cancer. We start with steroids, but we talk about that. If the patient is already having so much weakness, do expect a worsening of weakness. That's why I said steroid can be used, but in a controlled manner, and gradually need to titrate it up. You cannot start 60 and come low. You start 10, 15, or 20 and titrate it up. So different pattern of starting the treatment with steroids. But then there are oral immunosuppressants. In acute setting, naturally, you're not going to use that because these drugs easily take 6 to 9 months to kick in. So don't start oral. That would be a wrong answer if you say oral immunosuppressant in a patient who is coming into emergency with myositis with a CPK of 10,000. In that case, you're going to use IVIG or rituximab could be used as a maintenance treatment in these patients. There are more, again, I do get those, but I think in medicine, they're not going to ask you. This is a slide which just explained what I have explained in the last slide. But the only thing I want to emphasize in this particular slide is the time. So you do see over here they mention, check the response. So give neurologists some time to make the decision because we need a couple of months to decide to get to the next step or not. It cannot happen right away. So you can do IVIG, but for the maintenance treatment to make sure our patient is improving or not, are we going to call it a treatment failure? We easily need 8 weeks or more to make that decision. But they do have cyclophosphamide, which can be used. So there are more therapies, naturally with more side effects. In summary, the history examination for chronology and pattern recognition can set the ground. Basic investigations along with the ancillary testing are usually helpful. Tertiary care referral center requires specialist evaluation. Still a good number of complex neurological patients remain undiagnosed, not uncommon. Stepwise approach is usually high yield for correct diagnosis and treatment. Easy said than done. I'm happy to answer any question that you guys have.